I'd like to start off today with just a quick review of what we did cover yesterday. We went over, these were definitions, you know, optimization, minimization, design variables, degrees of freedom, the design space, an objective function. These were a list of things that you guys had hoped to learn, and I'm hoping to hit on a few more of those today. We didn't cover all of those yesterday. So anyway, we have a few more things we'd like to cover today with that. We talked about how the requirements for optimization is that you have a function that a set of X's produces one output within some model error. And then number two, that it's quantitative output. We don't have a way to optimize qualitative things. Talk about local optimum, global optimum. Somebody introduced us to geogebra.org. Thank you for that. Let's see, we talked about the general setup for any optimization case is that you have inputs going into some model or function or system that produces some outputs or an objective. And then that gets looped around to an optimization algorithm that's making the decisions of what to try next, right? And yesterday we focused on gradient-based optimization. So basically this optimization algorithm would be making small perturbations in these inputs to be able to compute the gradient, the change in the solution with respect to those inputs, and then make a decision on where to step next or what direction to search in order to find the minimum. We talked about limitations on the inputs. Those are called bounds. Limitations on the outputs are called constraints. So you can usually have a single objective, but then there may be other things coming out of this system that we need to constrain. And so limitations on those are called constraints. We talked about different ways to solve this. Basically, these are kind of the main four that I'm aware of. Yesterday we focused on gradient-based. Today we're going to be going over genetic algorithms, although I'd like to do a couple more things with gradient-based first before we switch gears. You can do trial and error, brute force, and there are others out there. In fact, the Nelder-Mead is a type of simplex algorithm, as I understand it. We might have time to touch on that at some point today. So gradient-based algorithms. We talked about what the gradient is. It's related to the derivative, which is basically the slope at any point. The Hessian is related to the second derivative and tells us about the curvature. And so another requirement for gradient-based algorithms is that they're continuous. And there are different ways to estimate the gradient and Hessian. You can do that analytically if you have a function, but usually we don't have a direct function. And so usually you end up using finite differencing. There's forward or backward differencing, central differencing. Central differencing is second order accurate, so you get a little bit more accuracy, but it's also a little bit more computationally expensive. We did some exercises, plug these things into Excel to visualize the design space. We computed the gradient analytically and numerically. We talked about, analytically, this was the solution, central differencing and forward differencing. We talked about that. And then, over here. We talked about different kinds of gradient-based optimization methods. So steepest descent is perhaps the simplest, and it's guaranteed to go downhill, rapid progress, far from the optimization, slow if the function is eccentric and only requires the gradient. It never computes the Hessian or the second derivative. Newton's method requires both the gradient and the Hessian, but the benefit there is that it can converge in a single step if the design space is quadratic. It requires the second derivatives in order to compute the Hessian, not guaranteed to go downhill. Sometimes it will step to a saddle point, a maximum or a minimum. It's just trying to find a point where the gradient is zero. And so in the best, what we'd really want is something that starts off as steepest descent and approaches Newton's method. And these are called quasi-Newton or variable metric methods. They start with the steepest descent, basically. They move towards a Newton's method. And many of them do not require the Hessian to be directly computed. They estimate that over time by understanding the first derivative at two different points or multiple points along the surface, and they can estimate what the Hessian is without ever having to compute a second derivative. These are guaranteed to go downhill. They can handle eccentric functions really well. These are three of them: rank one Hessian inverse update, the David and Fletcher Powell, and the Broyden Fletcher Goldfarb Shano BFGS method, which is by far the most popular today. There's also some other methods that are gradient based, conjugate gradient method. And actually, I'm not sure, I put Excel there. I'm actually not sure that Excel has that in there. Excel does have the GRG method in there. Sequential quadratic programming, so SQP, there's another version of that, least squares, SLSQP. The SQP and GRG methods can handle constraints, and that's one of their big benefits over the BFGS method up here. BFGS method technically cannot handle constraints. Now, there is one thing I wanted to mention about that sometimes you can put in what I would call artificial constraints into an unconstrained. So we call this unconstrained optimization up here because there's no fences. You know, we talked about what a fence might look like. In fact, I think we've got a drawing over here. So yeah, bounds and constraints. So if we don't have any fences in the design space, we don't have any constraints, then we can use an unconstrained optimization method. So BFGS is, like I said, one of the most popular for that. But you can put in what I call artificial constraints by putting in a penalty on the objective function or the objective value that comes out anytime it violates a constraint. And so you basically artificially inflate the objective function if it violates a constraint. And so it has to pay a penalty for violating that constraint. And so basically that can kind of rework your design space a little bit so that it moves uphill in the regions where it's violating constraints. So, and it moves uphill proportional to the magnitude that it's violating that constraint. And so that naturally gives it a gradient there to push it back downhill to satisfy that constraint. So that's one way to use the BFGS method, even for constrained optimization. Okay, one of the big differences between SQP and GRG is that SQP is not guaranteed to satisfy constraints during the optimization process, but it is guaranteed to satisfy it at the final step. You know, so in our example over here, it may wander past these fences, but eventually it will get back to that point that does satisfy the constraints, where the GRG method will never cross a fence, basically. And so it will be sure that all of its steps satisfy the constraints. Okay, and then we played around in Excel a bit and tried out a few things on there with Excel. So that's basically what we covered yesterday. Any questions on any of that before we move on with today? Okay, so today, the first thing I would like to go over is still with gradient-based optimization. I'd like to move into Python and spend some time in Python, getting comfortable with what's available there and what the settings are in the solvers. And now that we have an idea of what's under the hood, you know, what they're doing. And so we're gonna talk about two different tools here. So Python for gradient-based optimization. Okay, we're going to talk about two different tools. The first one is called Optics, and this is the tool that's developed in our lab. Corey wrote it, and it's based off of the book or notes. You know, I'm not sure what to call it, really. When I took the optimization course, during my master's degree, my professor's name, his last name is Parkinson. I can't remember his first name. But anyway, he had a set of notes that was kind of in a book form. And so that's basically what optics is written from, those notes. And so optics has three different methods in it: the BFGS method, the SQP, and the GRG methods. Okay. And so we're gonna spend some time with that, and then we're going to go to the Scipy library. So Scipy has something called .optimize, .minimize. And so this is basically installed if you're using like Anaconda Python installation, you know, it comes with the SciPy library. So, and it's got a whole bunch of options in here. So we'll actually, let me just pull up the website for that. So here's scipy.optimize.minimize. So this is scipy.org. You can just search for this. scipy.optimize.minimize, and it'll bring you to this page. But these are the methods that it has inside of it. So Neldermead, Powell, which I'm not sure, I know roughly what Neldermead is. I'm not really sure what Powell is, or CG, but here's the BFGS. You can see that. Here's a Newton CG. Here's an alternate BFGS method, TNC. Okay, here's SLSQP, which we've talked about. And I don't see GRG on here, which I'm a little surprised, but apparently they don't have GRG. So, and maybe there's another one of these that is the GRG method and it's just going by another name. But anyway, there's a whole bunch of different options in here.